That was beautiful, Debbie. Chris and the entire Tompkins family welcomes each of you to a celebration of our beloved, rascally, visionary friend, Doug, whom history will recall as Douglas Rainsford Tompkins. And first of all, I want to thank Chris and the Tompkins family, especially Quincy and Dan Imhoff for, well, them and a huge crew of people who helped to create a place where we can celebrate our friend Doug's amazing life, tell our myriad of Doug's stories, and share our sadness for the loss of our amazing friend. Let's also remember friends that can't be here today, especially Doug's 99-year-old mother, Faith, and friends on every continent, on the United, you know, around the world that loved and admired Doug as well. I'm Peter Buckley, one of the many, many people here whose life trajectories were altered, definitely for the better, by Doug. And I thought maybe starting today, a good way to start would just be for a few seconds to close your eyes if you want and conjure up an image of Doug. I'm sure you've got many. What comes to mind? You know, you might be recalling perhaps Doug working on architecture, art, activism, building a company, perhaps Esprit or the North Face, publishing, kayaking, climbing, farming, so many different realms. And Doug 100% committed to each. And you begin to wonder how one person could be so big to fill so many lives and to fill so many stories, how one person could have so much impact in so many different ways. You know, I met Doug in 1969. He walked into a gym where I was and asked if I'd teach him how to bounce on the trampoline. And I was pretty good at the time. And I'm sure it's no surprise to any of you that in 6 months, Doug had caught up and was pushing me to do harder tricks. And that trying harder stuff has gone on for 45 years now. Pushing your limits, full commitment, you hear that no matter what when it comes to Doug. So in welcoming all of you, I ask myself, what is it that connects all of us? What connects all these Doug stories? And why do we care, despite the fact that Doug could be, at times, extraordinarily exasperating? And the answer in my mind is written on the sign that Doug himself placed at the Via Chacabuco Cemetery where he's buried. And that sign reads, "No synonym for God is so perfect as beauty." No synonym for God is so perfect as beauty. John Muir. And beauty, that's the thread that connects everything, all the stories, all of us. In Doug's mind, beauty was not something subjective, not something that was a matter of human judgment. Doug's definition was probably closer to Robinson Jeffers. The greatest beauty is organic wholeness, the wholeness of life and things, the divine beauty of the universe. Doug believed that all forms of life possess their own aesthetic value, that all of nature has intrinsic value, and that value exceeds human favor or disfavor. And to mourn the loss of life, especially biodiversity, is also to mourn the loss of beauty. For Doug, there's a relationship between sustainability and beauty. In his publishing, he named that relationship, saying in many different ways that if we're to understand the widespread destruction of our current culture, we must attend to the loss of beauty. It's a zero-sum game. Doug's commitment was to reconnect beauty with life itself and with our efforts to sustain the world. Attend to beauty at every level, in every place, all the time. That was Doug. And he used to say, actually, if anything can save the world, I put my money on beauty. And you know, when I got the call about Doug's death, I was deeply shocked. I'd never, like all of you, I never lost anybody so close. And I found myself trying to reconcile the mundane with the seemingly catastrophic news. And in front of me on my desk was a copy of the Land Institute's report. And my eyes fell on a sentence by Wes Jackson, who is retiring. And Wes said, if you can complete your job in one lifetime, you're just not thinking big enough. Well, I don't think anybody ever accused Doug of not thinking big enough. And Doug's capacity to accomplish big things was vastly enhanced when he fell in love with Chris McDivitt, his beloved beauty and Birdie. Something happened to Doug when Chris entered his life. A few extra dimensions opened up, especially his emotions. And I'm sure Chris coached Doug probably extensively on how to become more user-friendly, I guess. His sweet side came into view more often, and despite his pessimism about the world, he became a much happier person. Nourished by Chris's love, he became even more effective at his work, and together with Chris and all of her skills, their conservation work jumped to another level, especially with Chris taking the lead with Patagonia National Park, and that right after creating Monte Leone National Park with Doug. Chris was, as they say, all in, and that was something that Doug deeply admired in his sweetheart. Doug wasn't big on discussing emotions, something of an understatement, but he could not contain sharing how much he loved Chris. Everyone who is at Doug's memorial and funeral in Chile witnessed the courage and strength Chris showed in sharing her loss. And a day after the funeral, Chris headed off to visit each of the projects in Chile and Argentina to console and to reassure all the staff, and along the way, visited the president of Chile and Argentina and talked to the press to give the same message. Please welcome Chris McDivitt Tompkins.
Peter's right. My name is Birdie. And while I may be wobbly up here, I am not alone. My family is here. Our families are here, with the exception, as Peter said, of our 99 and 97-year-old mothers. Our tribe of lifelong friends are here, and leaders of our team in Chile, Argentina, and the United States. They are all here. I've come from Chile for this gathering My life with Doug began there with a mildly scandalous and wild leap of faith. And we have lived in very isolated places ever since. And this is the life that we chose, and that's the life we wanted. In the early years, only radios connected us to the outside world. No internet, no phones, no roads. And I have often thought that this was likely the only way two such hard-headed and opinionated people could possibly grow together the way that we did. We were each other's sole source of entertainment. We were each other's sole source of support. And though this life began as a rush of wild confidence, and let's face it, a hunch, those early years forged something between us that will last forever. I remember, upon hearing early on that I would go visit Doug in Chile for 10 days, Gerrymander said, 10 days? No one can be alone with Doug Tompkins for 10 days. And he wasn't necessarily wrong. There were many flights of flying in South Chile with weather so bad that when we finally landed, I would hop down from the plane and I literally kissed the ground. And certainly the story of my mutiny of an extended sailing trip in the dead of winter in the high latitudes, leaving Doug on the boat and hitchhiking all the way back to Pumalin by myself. But Jerry, I can tell you with a full heart that what became nearly 9,000 days together, in fact, turns out to be a very small number and not nearly enough. We flew thousands of hours together, covering rough terrain of the extreme south, and me really only relaxing once we were over the Andes and into the flats of Argentina. Doug knew the landscape intimately. His memory for the details of terrain of the southern cone was so extraordinary. He favored the smaller Husky and left the bigger plains to Rodrigo and Fernando. And in his Husky, he shouldered the tightest curves, cutting close to waterfalls, tucked away, and skimming the tight white skin on the summits of volcanoes and ice fields. Doug flew so close to the ground. We have photographs that surely could not have been taken from the air, but as Antonio Vizcaíno and Linda Wadehofer know so well, they were. His confidence as a pilot really hit the peak before or at the time of the accident. And today the Husky sits in Valle Chacabuco, and now our longtime pilot, Rodrigo, flies it, his Doug's beloved plane. A few days ago, we took off at dawn and flew up to Cerro Cristine, a beautiful high peak in the park named for me by Doug, by Evo, and by Rick on their first ascent. And we flew so slowly around the summit, just circling around and around, and I thought to myself, he left me so much. He left all of us so much. I think Doug's love of wildlands began as a young boy climbing in the Shuangunks, but his deep identification with land surely came through flying. His decades spent climbing and boating cemented his love of being in the outdoors. But I think his deepest love and understanding of the masterpieces of landscapes and the terrible havoc and destruction that's tearing them apart came through his eyes as a pilot. He flew in through the doors of John Muir's Grand Cathedral of the Natural World. He did not go by foot. It's impossible to distill Doug's life into one Sunday afternoon, but you'll hear from people today who love Doug and who represent the different parts of his life and throughout you'll find a thread that is resounding. He sought beauty in his life in all things. He was unafraid with a wild streak and was a fierce defender of those things who have no voice of their own. Doug lived 100 lives within one life. I often told him that I calculated the years of our marriage like you do that of a dog, 7 years for every year. And finally, I was right. He was propelled by so many fronts and worked tirelessly in a speed that really I found astonishing, and people think that I'm a little bit of a whirling dervish myself. I don't know where this came from, but it was there. And one of the things I think he would say today, if he could, would be that we get out of bed every day and do something fierce for those things that call to us, for those things that we love, for the wild things in the sea, across the dark forests, our beloved grasslands and the creatures who live there. As the poet Mary Oliver wrote, "Tell me, what is it you plan to do with your one and precious life?" Remarkable things began to appear when Doug left on December 8th. By the end of the day, a small stream of letters began to appear that grew into thousands. Classrooms closed, flags lowered. Doug appeared in the news in every corner of the planet. Presidents of Chile and Argentina were met. By unanimous vote in the Chilean National Congress, Doug became an honorary Chilean citizen. Something he always wished for, and something unimaginable 20 years ago as military planes were flying low over our house. 5 days after the accident, the New York Times published an article about a Polish physicist discovering a new particle in the universe, and I thought to myself, this can only be Doug. And today, so many of you gathering here to celebrate one man's life, so well lived, I find this remarkable, generous, and wildly kind to celebrate Doug in this way. In the South, the condors are gliding. The pumas are eyeing their prey. The grasslands are swaying from the harsh winds of the west. The rainforests, forests of Pumalin are dense in their sadness. The jaguars tense with the sounds of something unseen. And each of these sounds and these fleeting moments bring to me a kind of unsteady solace in what we began 25 years ago, but a very clear, strong, and determined step forward from here. I love him. I can't imagine a life without him. He promised me love through eternity and out into infinity 1,000 times. And I am holding him to his word. Doug was a loyal friend and mentor. Many of the friendships in this room span decades. Doug met Yvon Chouinard nearly 60 years ago. I'm 65 years old. The other night, it occurred to me that I spent nearly 25 years working with Yvonne and then 25 years with Doug, leaving me only 15 years of my life to account for. I leave you with Yvonne. Thank you for coming.
Well, like Chris said, Doug was my friend for almost 60 years. We first met climbing in the Schwangunks in New York. He was only 15 years old and had either dropped out of or been kicked out of school. I don't know which one. In any case, he probably thought the teachers had nothing important to teach him. If you want to understand an entrepreneur, study a juvenile delinquent. That was Doug. Over the years, I taught him to surf. He taught me to kayak. We learned to climb mountains together. We boldly broke the rules of business and made it work. Doug was good at many do sports. Skiing, fencing, tennis, squash, sailing, and of course, climbing. Together, we did an early ascent of the Salathe Wall on El Capitan in Yosemite, which at the time was considered one of the most difficult rock climbs in the world. We climbed in Canada, Scotland in the winter, the Karakoram Range, Bhutan, Antarctica, and of course, Patagonia, where we climbed Fitzroy together. We fell in love with the area, and later I built a company around that mysterious name, and Doug spent a fortune in protecting its natural beauty. From so many days living among mountains and rivers, we expanded our love of nature to include the whole of this lovely planet. Doug was especially influenced by the Norwegian climber Arne Næss and his philosophy of deep ecology. Early on, we recognized that we humans were destroying our planet and that each of us in our own way was responsible to protect and restore the wild nature that we loved. We were always looking for an adventure, but there's no possibility of adventure without risk. Sometimes you have to purposely leave a crack open in the door for the opportunity of a good fight or possible serendipity. We loved life and were not afraid of death, but did not wish to die. Doug had little respect for authority. He didn't like anyone telling him what to do, but he didn't hesitate in lecturing others. On a Du Bois kayaking trip to the Russian Far East, our only maps went flying out the window of the helicopter. We all exchanged high fives. We're on our way to an adventure. Another time we made the first descent of the Maipo River outside of Santiago, Chile. We eddied out before a blind turn with a roar on the other side, and Doug got out to scout. Two soldiers came up from behind with guns pointed at his back and demanded to see his papers. He told them to get stuffed, ran down the hill, jumped into his boat, and took off around the bend. I was totally freaked out, not knowing what was around the corner, and the thought of getting shot in the back. Sure enough, I hit a big keeper and went over, questioning whether to roll up or not. Later, we found out that the river flowed through the dictator Pinochet's summer grounds.
On that fateful day last December, I was a little shocked to see how frail the old fig looked. But then he probably thought the same of me. I think he'd been spending too much time in front of the computer. I can't use that excuse for myself. Doug was dressed in his signature press chinos, his Brooks Brothers shirt, a light wool sweater, and a light rain jacket. This was the same outfit he wore to climb the last mountain we did together, Cerro Christine. On the lake, we ran into a perfect trap. 40-knot wind at our back and an equally strong wind from the side, making for large, confused waves. We could not even miss one paddle stroke for fear of going over. The boys made a valiant effort, but we lost Doug. We lost the chief. And by his actions, Doug became the teacher we all needed, and he still is. And I'm here to say for Chris and her team, and with the support of all of you, his work is going to continue. Thank you.
We're at the part of the program where we get to meet the Tompkins family, and the first person you'll meet is his younger brother, John Tompkins.
Hello and welcome. I'm really impressed at how many people have come. This is a great memorial to my brother's life and his many accomplishments. What a shock that he died, but it wasn't a surprise. He's lived on the edge for as long as I can remember. He had he was tremendously courageous in his life. Myself, my mother, my father passed away a few years ago, but we were all very immensely proud of him. Our mother, Faith, was born in 1916, raised in South Dakota. She will be 100 at the end of this July. She went to college in Minneapolis, went to New York City to work as a secretary in the mid-1930s. Our father, Jack Tompkins, was born in Penticton, British Columbia, in 1914. He moved to Oakland, California when he was 16 with his mother. He went to Berklee College for 2 years, and after that moved to New York City, where his father was managing editor at the New York Herald Tribune. My father my father learned the antique business from my grandfather and another dealer. My mother and father met in New York City, married, and later Jack joined the U.S. Air Force, becoming a glider pilot and fighting in the Second World War, and was part of the D-Day invasion by the Allied forces in Europe. Doug was born in 1943 during these years of war. I was born in 1947 in New York City, where my parents had been living in Greenwich Village. Doug had an imaginary dog at that time that lived underneath the piano. When I was 2 months old, we moved 100 miles north of the city, and our parents rented a house on a sheep and horse farm. Doug is 4 years older than I. When we were living there, I recall the fire department coming, and my mother looking out the back door. It was at night, and there was haystacks on fire. And the fire chief was telling my father, he said, it looked like suspicious fires. They found matches near the haystacks. And my brother was hiding behind my mother's skirt, just kind of looking around. After we lived at that place for 4 years, we moved to a farm that my parents had bought about 5 miles away, and that's where we grew up. We raised sheep and horses and chickens at the time, and my father had a sideline business of antiques. And I think we had 70 Dorset sheep, 3 scrub race horses, and 1 large pony, about 30 or 40 Bantam chickens, a Dalmatian dog, and a couple of stray cats. we sold the, Doug at that time belonged to the 4-H Club, and he took 4 of his sheep to the Dutchess County Fair and won a blue ribbon. Later, we, about 5-6 years later, we got rid of all the sheep, and my father went in full-time into the antique business, where he made quite a bit of money, and he was able to afford to send us to private schools for a few years, but Doug got kicked out, and I wasn't invited back. So we went to high school. Doug never finished high school. He was a half credit short. And never went back to school after that. We didn't, just to skip over here. From as long as I can remember, Doug loved sports and had many sports idols, such as Jackie Robinson or Babe Ruth or Yogi Berra, Mickey Mantle, and many others. He played many sports that Yvonne said, but he played a lot more. He played soccer, football, ice hockey, basketball, squash, lacrosse, loved to swim, and windsurfing and skiing, of course, tobogganing, sledding, volleyball, ping pong, plus hacky sack, and frisbee. But he most significantly loved the outdoor activity of climbing and kayaking. Douglas was always into looking good and dressing well. He took excellent care of his clothes and his sports equipment. Our whole family skied. We first began skiing at Bel Air Ski Resort in the Catskills Mountains, and we all took lessons from the same ski instructor, Jim Andrus. Jim was a veteran from the Second World War, served in the Mountain Division as a Pando Commando. James was the man who first taught Doug to climb, and at the end of the summer of 1958, Doug went on his first climb. I talked to Jim last week. He's 92 years old now and living in North Carolina. And he said that Doug was a natural when it came to climbing. Jim taught me to climb the next year. Although I was much younger, it was still a great thing to accomplish just a single climb. I climbed with many of the other climbers in the gunks. They call their climbing club, the Vulgarians. And there's a big reason for that. If you go out climbing for a full day and you come and meet somebody else after cursing and swearing and trying to make some moves, you may be called a Vulgarian as well. I climb with Doug in the Gunks, in the Senecas, the Adirondacks, the Tetons, and some incredible caves, especially the Schoolhouse Cave in Seneca, which is considered quite technical. I remember the three of us, there were actually 4 of us that went in a no trespassing area, that some farmer had put all these fences and signs saying no trespassing, can't go in this, and there was a doorway into this cave, and it opened up into like a giant eggshell, bigger, as tall as the ceiling in this room. And we went through a little passage that had been dug out, and other spelunkers had been in there before, and they'd put in some stakes down so we could rappel over them and rappel over. And we came to these giant pits, and there was a stream or a river running way down below that you could hear in a rumble. And of course, we had our carbide lights on and our helmets on, and it was pitch dark. And we looked over into one of these pits, and somebody had put a sign down below in phosphorescent letters saying, at the end, you'll meet God. But we had to rappel down into there. I think I have to get off of here. I will miss him terribly, as I'm sure many others will. And I'm so happy that everyone showed up. Thank you very much.
Hi, everybody. I think a lot of you know that I'm Susie Tompkins Buell, and I've just had a lot of mixed emotions since I got here, you know, because it's so fun to see so many people from the past, and, you know, we're sad, but we're happy, and just have to, you know, we just have to deal with all that emotion. And so I think I'm just going to start off, because you all know who I am pretty much, but it is true that I did pick up hitchhiking when we were 20 years old. I can still see him today standing by the side of the road with his ropes all around him and carabiners hanging there. And I had been working as a keno runner up in one of the gambling casinos that summer. And I was very full of myself because I had bought my own first car for $170. So I stopped and he jumped in. And immediately I felt sort of arrogance because he was trying to impress me, and I can remember so well when I said, well, where do you come from? And he said, I live in the Better Coast. So he was thinking New York was so much better than the Bay Area or Tahoe. It is also true that a few days after that, I bailed him out of jail. And he was, I guess he was hungry, but he was caught stealing steak at the Safeway. And so a mutual friend of ours came and found me in the casino where I was working as a keno runner and said, you know that guy, Tompkins from New York, well, he needs some help. And so I said, what do you need? And he said, well, we need some money. So I remember I had $65 in my little thing that I wore as a keno runner, and I gave him the $65. And Doug came in a couple of days later. Now, he was a little humbled at this point to thank me for bailing him out of jail. So we were young and impetuous and absolutely afraid of nothing. We got in his old VW bus and drove down to Mexico and just had crazy times. We were barefoot the whole time. And a few months later, we drove back east to Millbrook, New York, where I met Johnny. And we got married in Doug's family home in Millbrook, New York. And that was a really sweet and special moment. So after that, we drove our van, Doug's van, we drove back to Tahoe, and we stayed at Tahoe for a little while. And then we moved down to San Francisco, where we started the North Face. Now we're on the Better Coast. We're really settling in. And we lived in an alley in Chinatown called Emery Lane, literally in Chinatown, $80 a month rent. But it was next to a mortuary in the alley, and every day we had fresh flowers. So Then the North Face was happening. It was a very interesting location in North Beach. And I remember our opening party. I don't quite remember how we did it, but I know that we had the Grateful Dead playing at our opening. They were young and undiscovered, and they just said, yeah, they'd come and play. And we had Hell's Angels as bouncers. And suddenly it became quite the happening thing that was going on down there. So after the opening, we took the Grateful Dead and the Hell's Angels to Vanessi's for dinner. Now you can imagine what Vanessi's thought when we walked in with them. Our first daughter, Quincy, was born in 1965, and we would take her to the store every day. We used to put her in the window on a reindeer rug, and she became kind of a neighborhood attraction. We were naked. Remember that, Yvonne? And the North Face was between the Condor and Big Al's, and I think it's true. And it was very fun. It was very kind of crazy, but we just kept figuring out, okay, let's do this, let's do that. And Yvonne was talking last night about all the bikinis. I went one time, Doug said, why don't you go to France and see if you can find anything to buy in the store? So I went to France, and I found a bikini manufacturer. And nobody'd ever heard of a bikini, so I brought back bikinis, and we sold so many bikinis because Yvonne had a little scheme to help market those. So soon Doug was feeling tied down by retail. He's just getting itchy to move around. And North Face was having some growing pains, and they were, you know, it was bothering him because he had other things to do. So we decided to sell it, or he decided to sell it. And I think we sold it for $40,000. That mind is in my mind. $40,000 to get out of debt with a little bit of money left over. And with that little bit of money that was left over, Doug bought a used Ferrari. Yeah, Doug had a Ferrari. Doug Tompkins had a Ferrari. In 1967, when I was expecting our second child, Doug was eager to get down to Chile to climb Mount Fitzroy. The baby was due mid-June, but not cooperating with Doug's schedule. He worried that he was missing the best weather conditions, so he made plans to go and told me to hurry it on up. Summer was born on the first day of summer in 1967, the summer of love. A few days later, Doug left for South America with his friends, the Fun Hogs. That included Yvon Chouinard, who became Quincy's godfather and Doug's lifelong comrade. There is always a calm sweetness and soulfulness and insightfulness about Yvon, even then, and it really helped to calm Doug's high impulsive energy. While Doug was gone for months in Chile, I juggled new baby Summer with her sister Quincy, who was 2 years old. It was sure luck that Doug and I had met Jane Tice earlier, and together, Jane and I put together a very small collection of fun dresses that we called Plain Jane. We began peddling the samples from the back of a Volvo station wagon. When Doug Pink came back from Chile several months later and saw the immense amount of orders we had, he could see the potential of Plain Jane and realized that we had a viable business on our hands, but we needed capital. Doug had bought the Ferrari with the North Face money, and as the reality of our finances set in, he realized the Ferrari had to go. Remember, this was in the early 60s, and deep ecology was way, way in the future. Back in those days, Doug was a capitalist. The business was growing like wildfire, and we needed a corporate name. Doug liked the play on words of the word esprit de corps. I don't know, he'd seen that somewhere. It was a military unit or something. And so I remember him asking me, I was folding the laundry, and he said, what do you think of the name esprit de corps? I thought, oh, what does it mean? And he said, well, it you know, let's just do it. I said, fine. And then we looked it up, and it had a very very beautiful sound to it. It meant the shared spirit and endeavor of a group of people working together toward a common vision and goal. And really, at that point, we did not know what we had on our hands in the way of our company. The word "but" was never part of Doug's vocabulary. He took the company international, bringing other talented people on board from all over the world. In 1976, our headquarters in San Francisco was firebombed by the union and burned to the ground. The next morning, sitting across from this, in this burned out shell that was still smoldering, sitting with Doug, he looked at me, and I remember so well exactly what he said. He said, "Well, there's only one way to go from here, and that's up." And that was so Doug. He was so refused to be defeated. Doug rallied all hands on deck and was at his best getting the company back on track. This galvanized us all, and we rose from the ashes. Whether it was outdoor adventure or business, it was all the same to Doug, a challenge to master. Our esprit de corps helped us build an even stronger business. This was really the time when the company's true culture emerged. We had built a world-famous brand with offices and stores in many countries, but it had grown too big for us to handle. We had also begun to realize that the world didn't need another colorful t-shirt. We were struggling to find solutions to lessen the impact of our massive production on the environment, the intense production. Dyeing, packaging, shipping, all had consequences. We knew there must be life after Esprit and decided it was time to find other ways to make a difference, which meant selling the business and moving forward along our different paths. By that time, Esprit had become a very, very important, vibrant, international brand. The sale of Esprit gave Doug the chance to do what he'd always wanted, to move to Chile to protect the land that he had grown to love and that he realized was under siege. Together with his adoring and adored new wife and his life companion, Chris, they were able to create spectacular projects in South America. Doug, like many adventurous, visionary entrepreneurs, was complicated. One of Doug's greatest challenges and gifts was that he saw the imperfections before acknowledging the accomplishments, and that could be painful. It was difficult for Doug to acknowledge or to thank those who made great efforts to help him. If today was simply an Esprit reunion and he was here with us, I think that he would take a moment to extend his deep gratitude to all of you that helped us build Esprit. You must hold in your heart the knowing that you were a great part of his legacy, that you made it possible for Doug and Chris to create a foundation that will benefit tomorrow's world. With Chris by his side, Doug is accomplishing an extraordinary mission that will live on. So thank you all for making this possible, and I don't only mean the Esprit alumni. We all learned so much from Doug. He challenged us way beyond our own self-expectations, and we found our strengths in meeting those goals for him. From Doug's shortcomings, I certainly learned that being intolerant and judgmental keeps you from understanding some of life's greatest joys. Sometimes the most painful lessons are the most important in the world. For all of Doug's accomplishments, in my heart, the greatest of these is Quincy and Summer, our daughters. Summer, for as difficult as it was to have had such a demanding father, out of this you have become such a strong woman and an exceptional mother. You are, without question, both as tender and powerful that a woman could be, and I'm so proud of you. Quincy, your father had faith in all of your abilities, and you lived up to them. Today's tribute to your father is testimony of your love and respect for him. You have honored him greatly. I am so proud and joyful that Doug and I maintained a respectful and loving relationship and that it ended on a note of grace. We really knew that we had been a gift to each other. He will live in my heart and in my memories forever. I will see him in our children, Quincy and Summer, and in our grandchildren, Gardner and Willa and Brooks Thomas and Della and Susie Kate. As you navigate through your lives, Doug will be with you and will always be a part of you. Chris, you gave Doug the best last chapter of his life. His accomplishments with you are his legacy, and we are so proud and loving of you.
On behalf of all of the grandchildren, Della Walker, my cousin, and I will be reciting one of our Grandpa Doug's favorite poems, The Brown Forest by Robinson Jeffers.
The Brown Forest. I enter the life of the brown forest and the great life of the ancient peaks, the patience of stone. I felt the changes in the veins, in the throat of the mountain. A grain in many centuries, we have our own time, not yours. And I was the stream, draining the mountain wood, and I the stag drinking. And I was the stars, boiling with light and wandering alone, each one the lord of his own summit. And I was the darkness. Outside the stars, I included them. They were a part of me.
Not done. I was mankind also. A moving lichen on the cheek of the round stone, they have not made words for it. To go beyond things, beyond hours and ages, and be all things and all time, in their returns and passages, in the motionless white and timeless center, in the wild white of the fire. How can I express the excellence that I have found, that has no color but clearness, no honey but ecstasy, nothing wrought nor remembered, no undertone nor silver second murmur that rings in love's voice. I and my loved are one, no desire but fulfilled, no passion but peace, the pure flame and the white, fierier than any passion, no time but spherical eternity. Okay. I'm Gardner Imhoff, son of Quincy and Dan.
And I'm Willa Imhoff.
I'm Brooks Thomas.
I'm Della.
I'm Susie.
And next, we're going to hear a song from a dear friend of our great-grandmother's, Faith, Therese Bolaña, and she will be accompanied by Juan Pablo Orega.
Good afternoon. This song is a Spanish song. And it has been written by a wonderful woman named Violeta Parra at about the time where Doug discovered Patagonia. And this song, it's a nod to life and a nod to love. And I dedicate it to Doug and all of you. Gracias a la vida que me ha dado tanto, me dio dos luceros que cuando los abro perfecto distingo lo negro del blanco y en el alto cielo su fondo estrellado y en las multitudes el hombre que yo amo. Gracias a la vida que me ha dado tanto, me ha dado el sonido y el abecedario con las palabras que pienso y declaro, madre, amigo, hermano, y luz alumbrando la ruta del alma del que estoy amando.
Gracias a la vida que me ha dado tanto,
me ha dado la marcha de mis pies cansados. Con ellos anduve ciudades y charcos, playas y desiertos, montañas y llanos, y la casa tuya, tu calle, tu patio. Gracias a la vida que me ha dado tanto, me dio el corazón que agita su marco cuando miro el fruto del cerebro humano, cuando miro el bueno tan lejos del malo, cuando miro el fondo de tus ojos claros. Gracias a la vida
que me ha dado tanto, me ha dado la risa y me ha dado el llanto. Así yo distingo dicha de quebranto, los dos materiales que forman mi canto, y el canto de ustedes que es el mismo canto, y el canto de todos que es mi propio canto. Gracias a la vida, gracias a la
It's my honor to introduce Doug's friend, mentor, and intellectual sparring partner, Gerrymander. Jerry started out as one of those characters out of Mad Men, but unlike Don Draper, Jerry began to see clearly what advertising did as a system. He rebelled and ended up using his advertising skills for civil rights groups, anti-war groups, and especially environmental groups. Jerry founded started the first nonprofit advertising agency in the country. He's written four powerful books. He's founded influential organizations. But most importantly, he's mentored an entire generation of activists, including Doug. Brilliant, that's the word that Doug always used to describe Jerry. Please welcome Gerrymander.
Peter, thank you so much. That was very kind, and thank you all for being here. So, I knew Doug for 53 years, and I've been asked to give you a brief picture of the evolution of Doug's activism and thought in 5 minutes. So, I'm just gonna tell a few stories and see how far we can get in that. When we met in the mid-1960s, we were neighbors on Russian Hill. He was in his early 20s, a dedicated outdoor athlete, a downhill ski racer. He was hoping to make the Olympic team, as we heard from Yvonne, until an injury set him back. He was also a highly advanced mountain climber with many ascents of dangerous peaks, as Yvonne mentioned. I was super envious of Doug's outdoor exploits and his bravery in wilderness. I had none of those skills and was not at all tempted to try, but I was very impressed. Even way back then, Doug spoke a lot about his passion for the beauty of nature, and I'm very glad Peter brought that up earlier. He spoke of nature's beauty as itself a major natural resource. That beauty itself needed legal protection, just as much as clean air or clean water. That was a rare viewpoint, I thought, and it still is. Doug later projected that fundamental idea into all his books and foundation programs. So one could say that there really wasn't all that much of an evolutionary development with Doug. He was into nature's beauty as a primary factor of life back in the middle 1960s, and he told me back to his teenage years. Here's another short story. In 1966, Doug and Susie launched North Face, as we've heard, a wonderful, wonderful shop at Columbus and Broadway in North Beach. I'd go visit him at the shop. We'd hang out at Cafe Trieste for coffee and chatter away. At the time, I was also a friend of Bill Graham. We had worked together on the Trips Festival. And Doug asked me if I could arrange to hire for a big upcoming party at the ski shop, The Grateful Dead. So I did it. I did, and they played at the shop. Mimi Farina also sang. Joan Baez was in the audience. It was really fun. I have a picture here of Susie standing with Pigpen, who was the famous drummer of the band. Those were the good old days. If you don't have this, I'll give it to you. In the mid-1960s, I was in the advertising business, first in the commercial business. And I was amazed that Doug was so interested in discussing the details of advertising thought, design, art, and copy. He was especially excited when our agency did the big advertising campaigns of the mid-1960s for David Brower and the Sierra Club that kept dams out of Grand Canyon and established Redwood Park, among others. Doug felt that this kind of campaign could have great power, and in fact, he then adapted that style brilliantly 30 years later, doing his own very successful campaigns to beat back terrible dam developments in Chile, which I hear are maybe coming back. Doug was also very impressed by Brower's publishing program. By 1965, the Sierra Club had published 25 exhibit format books relating to wilderness. 3 decades later, as we know, Doug was deeply into publishing glorious books, as you can see in the lobby. He called Brower his environmental hero and teacher. Doug later introduced Dave to Arne Næss, the founder of the deep ecology movement in Norway, Doug's other number one environmental hero. By 1968, Doug joined with Susie and Peter Buckley in the glamorous early days of Esprit. Doug poured himself into the fine points of commercial design and artistic expression. And yet by the late 1970s, he was privately saying that he longed to apply his talents toward political engagement that would express his love for nature. He was reading voraciously by then, books by Gary Snyder, who I think is here, Edward Abbey, Thoreau, Ivan Illich, Wendell Berry, Ted Rozak, Langdon Winter, Wes Jackson, Arne Næss. My zeal for business began to fade away, he wrote later. Promotion of consumer products was not vital to anyone's needs, unquote. He spoke of the hollowness of capitalist pursuits, and he was especially embarrassed, he told me once, by those very popular Esprit t-shirts that he was promoting, and we all wore with the company name written across our chests. Tens of thousands of people became walking commercials. It was a brilliant promotion, but Doug said it was wrong. I was contributing to the problem itself. I had to figure out how to get on the solution side of things. Another expression of his growing concern in that period, middle 80s, early 80s, came at his house on Chestnut Street one night. Doug and some fellow named Steve Jobs broke into a friendly debate on whether the emerging new global cyber tech was going to save the world. Steve thought so. Doug thought the opposite, that it was separating human feeling, perception, and thought away from nature, as we could see on the streets every day. Doug sold his interest in Esprit in 1990 and moved to Chile to the mountains he loved. A few years later, he was joined by Chris, as we've heard, as they poured their efforts and funds and love and joy into those glorious parkland and restoration campaigns, and into a new foundation that would promote activist campaigns in related and underlying causes. Doug named it the Foundation for Deep Ecology to honor Arnie Ness's work. The granting work divided into three main categories: saving wildness and wilderness. He worked a lot with Dave Foreman. Raise your hand, Dave Foreman. He's in the room someplace. No? He was here last night. He had close working partnerships with Wes Jackson, that we'll hear from in a minute, Wendell Berry, and Andy Kimbrell, who's here also. Where are you, Andy? There he is. And the third was against economic globalization and mega technology. Doug was never satisfied to fight about symptoms. He demanded that discussions go deeper to root causes and ultimate consequences. If we have a global economic system, he said, that requires ever more growth and ever more profit, it inevitably leads to the massive extinction crisis now upon us. He called that the mother of all crises. If we continue to assume, as most people do, that human beings are the royalty of nature, anthropocentrism, the living planet is soon reduced to being a caged servant and ultimately revolts. Climate change, Zika virus, maybe. If we think technology will save us, then we don't understand the full scaffolding of processes, the dozens of stages of production, all with their own consequences. He loved describing the scaffolding of our innocent little cell phones and devices, mining, shipping, production, waste, and how cell phones are changing human beings as well, separating from us from nature and nature in ourselves. Well, I think I've reached my time limit already. So let me close by saying this, that over the last two decades, there's no doubt in my mind that Doug Tompkins had become the world's most effective, dedicated, and passionate environmental activist and paradigm warrior. He argued that we'll never save the world unless we totally revamp our thinking, our operating paradigms, and economic systems. He made it clear he would put his life on the line about that. Only 3 months ago, for example, he was with Paul Watson on the Sea Shepherd, directly confronting huge Japanese whaling ships near Antarctica during raging storms. Doug was totally inspired by that activity. But in the end, it was this very passion for nature that put him out on that lake last month with his old friends in a kayak during a storm, and that brings us here tonight. But I know that the people in this room and on this stage today share an understanding that the ball has been passed to us, and we remain dedicated to driving his vision in his name and memory and in behalf of wild nature. Thank you so much. And now it's my honor to present in person one of Doug's closest colleagues, teachers, and partners in the crucial work on local ecological monoculture and agriculture. And he was a close friend of Wes's for many years. And here we have Wes Jackson from the Land Institute.
Whoa, what a gathering. The gathering of the faithful. Well, a quarter century ago, Doug and I met in Washington, D.C. He was steeped in the thinking of Arnie Ness's ecology. I was little steeped. So as a consequence, he saw me as a project and was relentless at getting me squared away. But I had a lure that he could not resist. At the land, we were in the early days of our engagement in Matfield Green, Kansas, population 56, a town without a lifestyle. A house could be bought for as little as $500 to $1,000. The hotel in Cottonwood Falls, I let go at an auction in the courthouse for $45. Doug, the bargain hunter, flew in. The conversations about the necessity of both the wild and agriculture began. On the first trip south, Joan and I met Chris in Renaway, and from then on around the land, it was Doug and Chris, or Chris and Doug. Doug had been getting rid of his cattle at Renaway. Jeremy Ripken had written a book on how bad beef was, and I argued that grassland managed by fire and grazing are useful, sometimes necessary, management tools. We had our arguments. And once in frustration, I blurted out that if we don't do something about agriculture, wilderness is doomed. For whatever reason, Doug became an avid farmer, indeed an avid agriculturist. And what individual has done more to restore and rewild damaged lands? Who among us has ever seen agricultural landscapes more beautiful than Laguna Blanca? Given his devotion to beauty as the highest standard, I'll finish with this story. A few years ago, after the Prairie Festival, which is always the last weekend of September, Doug and I took a road trip to see the Missouri River Valley, and this was before his departure from the Kansas City Airport. We got to the airport, Doug discovered that he had his departure time wrong, which forced him to take a flight some 5 hours later. What to do? Well, years before, he told me that he had tried to buy Thomas Hart Benton's famous Persephone, but failed to outbid the Kansas City's Nelson Atkins Museum of Art. I suggested we go to the Nelson to see the painting. We walked in. I was prepared for us to go directly to Persephone. Doug was in no hurry. He took his time, checking out several works along the way, commenting here and there on both artists and artwork. An hour later or more, we were at the Persephone. He stopped, squared himself to the painting, expressed his pleasure that it had been cleaned up, that the frame was okay, but not what he would have done. He made some more comments, and we moved on. We came to another painting he knew well, but now came a full-blown critique. It went something like this. Beautiful, huh? But you know, I'll tell you, you know, the lighting, it's not good, huh? You know what I would have done? Here's what they need. Here's where they need the light, huh? Huh? And you know, that's not the best frame. You know what kind of frame I would have had? It'd have been about this wide, huh? I would have had it, yeah, about like that. And it wouldn't be dark like that, huh? It's positioned okay, but the light, the frame, and then finally, it's a great painting though, huh? They just need to do a little more to make it right. What do you think? As though my opinion mattered. Well, no detail was too small. for this architect, artist, environmentalist, agroecologist, organic no-till practitioner, beautification expert like Laguna Blanca Farm, restorer and rewilder of damaged lands, Shakespeare and Julius Caesar has Mark Antony say these words about the fallen Brutus, which could be a summary of the life of Doug Tompkins. His life was gentle, and the elements so mixed in him that nature might stand up and say to all the world, this was a man.
Chris and Doug's family, thank you for having me here. I feel really honored. And it's so good to be all together celebrating Douglas' life. This is a celebration, right? Bear with my English, please. You know? It's my third language or something like that. Sentiment without action is the ruin of the soul. Edward Abbey. This was one of Douglas' favorite ideas. And sentiment here not only refers to what the heart feels, but also to sentient, to what the mind perceives. Doug urged us to engage in systemic analysis and to really see what we are looking at. And to do this, he said that we need to have the fundamental intellectual infrastructure, actually a concept coined by Mr. Tom Butler, I understand. And this doesn't necessarily mean going to the university. Douglas was kicked out of school at 15 years old, as we heard, but rather with living life in a certain way. But also, in the case of Doug, with always looking for the company of and the partnership with people who feel and think deeply and act accordingly. Once you embark on this path, though, there's no way back. You will be looking at things through the lens of ecological history and process. Some people look at a dam and see a lake, or look at a plantation and see a forest, and maybe think they are beautiful. There's always beauty in water and in trees, but looking deeper, you will discover a drama, a magnificent river, a native forest that were obliterated for human needs. Some people look at a huge transmission line and they see progress and development. Doug was a very brave taboo breaker and didn't mind incurring in the wrath of many when doing so. He made us Chilean people see the double blow on Patagonia's unique forest caused first by the intentional fires promoted by the government just a century ago. 10 million acres of native forest were burned to clear the land for raising livestock, particularly tens of thousands of sheep for the English wool industry, followed by widespread overgrazing, a mining of the soil, as Douglas put it. Nobody dared to talk about this before because supposedly it is offensive to the heroic settlers who were just complying with mandatory public policy. For Doug, the truth was more important, because only the right, ruthless diagnosis might lead to healing, to restoration. Doug rocked our southern cone reality, truly, No wonder he dialogued with presidents and former presidents and ministers and senators and ambassadors and empresarios in Chile and Argentina, which doesn't mean he didn't dialogue with the gauchos and the farmers, and this wasn't an obstacle for him to become a friend and a work partner with the whole tribe of Chilean environmentalists, the radical ones, pacifists, but the radical, and for supporting all the good local environmental causes, defense of rivers, of native forests, organic agriculture, the questioning of industrial salmon farming, and of conventional energy and development policies and paradigms. There is no doubt that without Doug and Chris, we would have not stopped the Hidroaicén dams in Patagonia. We stopped a huge hydro complex thanks to Doug and Chris. And you know that he also converses constantly and fluently with many of the world's vanguard thinkers. Many are here today. And I will not mention his conservation efforts and achievement, because Tom Butler will soon. And so far, I have mentioned only Doug. But Doug and Chris are one, and did and achieved everything together. And with their fantastic teams, they coached and surrounded themselves with. I think we should also give an applause to Carolina Morgado, who's been the head of the Chilean team for 25 years. I have seldom seen such a synergistic and loving couple. Seriously. Envy almost, you know, seriously. We fought like cats in a bag, says Chris. But they are like bow and arrow, arrow and bow. It's amazing to hear them talk about each other when the other isn't around. Pure love and respect and conjunct environmental work ethos. And yes, I'm using the present tense here. Doug and Chris are beloved friends. Doug is here with us. He's in Chile and in Argentina and the many other places where he landed upon. All his friends, we are amazed at the tangible quality of his lingering presence, of his indelible footprint. That's really the mark of a great human being. Of course, we disagreed about fine points, but not about the larger, you know, picture, values, and goals. Finally, I would like to conjure the image of our last flight together in the famous Husky, circling too close around the recently collapsed crater of the Chaitén volcano, smelling the sulfurous fumes. And Douglas was taking pictures with that one hand, you know, we were on the side. Doug readily accepted the ravages caused by the eruption on a sector of one of their dearest projects, the Pumalin Park. No problem. He didn't tolerate, though, humanity's ecopathic predation of the present biosphere. The volcano did not have an option. Humanity does. Doug did his best to steer us in the direction of flowing with the intimidating, mysterious, and beautiful synergy of the biosphere. Thank you so much for your grace. Thank you. I have the pleasure to invite one of Doug's best friends, Rick Ridgeway, a fellow adventurer for 40 years. Please.
The poem I'm going to read you as an adaptation from Maya Angelou, and it's for Chris, because she's on a new path that she's necessarily forming each day as she learns to step forward. And it's a poem appropriate because it reminds us that when we have a new path in front of us, we know it's the right path when it's been formed so strongly by the path behind us. When a great tree falls, rocks on distant hills shudder, lions hunker down in tall grasses, and even elephants lumber after safety. When a great tree falls in a forest, small things recoil in silence, their senses eroded beyond fear. When a great soul dies, the air around us becomes light, rare, sterile. We breathe briefly, our eyes briefly, see with a hurtful clarity. Our memory, suddenly sharpened, examines, gnaws on kind words unsaid, promised walks never taken. A great soul dies, and our reality, bound to him, takes leave of us, our souls dependent upon his nurture, now shrink, wizened. Our minds, formed and informed by his radiance, fall away. We are not so much maddened as reduced to the unutterable ignorance of dark, cold caves. When a great soul dies, after a period, peace blooms, slowly and always, irregularly. Spaces fill with a kind of soothing electric vibration. Our senses restored, never to be the same, whisper to us, he existed. He existed. We can be and be better, for he existed.
Doug Tompkins was a great teacher, for he taught us how to see, to really look, and to think deeply. What do you see in the backdrop behind me? Beauty and the related qualities of integrity and health and wildness, the qualities that Doug Tompkins fought for, and the qualities that John Muir had championed earlier. In December of 1914, when John Muir died, it was big news. He was rightfully celebrated in that moment, but it took decades. It took the fullness of time for us to understand how John Muir's ideas about beauty and national parks and the value of nature for its own sake, not merely as some sort of a factory churning out resources for humanity, how these ideas would gain cultural traction and therefore influence history. 101 years later, in December 2015, when Doug Tompkins took his last trek into the big wild, it was also big news. And the news rocketed around the world, and those of us in the room were touched by that, as well as people who never met Doug. And only in the fullness of time will people be able to measure his contributions. But even so, let us try. Even as we are hobbled by our proximity to the living, breathing, extraordinary presence that was the Doug that we knew and loved, not the Doug of the future history books. And if judged on passion and ambition and success, we can only conclude that Doug Tompkins is the greatest conservationist of our time. Consider scale. Douglas and Chris, through their foundations, have acquired more than 2 million acres for permanent protection as national parks and other kinds of protected areas. And working in full and complete and joint partnership with Chris and the team of conservationists that they assembled and mentored, as well as with fellow philanthropists and three different presidents, they have already created 5 new national parks and dramatically expanded another, including this place, Yendagaya National Park in Tierra del Fuego. And that record of parklands protection is complemented by the most ambitious program of rewilding, of putting missing species and processes back into an entire ecosystem. The most ambitious program of rewilding anywhere in South America and very likely anywhere on Earth. Now, add to that the millions of dollars granted to grassroots biodiversity conservation groups, the campaigns that Doug helped fund, the campaign that Juan Pablo Arrego just mentioned to help keep Patagonia's wild rivers free and free of dams and alive, the more than 24 activism-focused books he published, the symposia and the conferences and the intellectual advocacy he advanced. In the brief minutes allotted to me, I couldn't even begin to scratch the surface of the breadth of the conservation accomplishments that Chris and Doug have managed to create, this body of work over the last quarter of century. It is, in a word, unprecedented. And even more importantly, it is not over. It is not over. The work for beauty, for integrity, for health, and wildness goes on. And each of us has an opportunity to participate in that work in whatever capacity we may have, inspired by Doug's example. Chris could not be more clear that this work will go on. And even now, the Tompkins Conservation Team is working to secure at least 6, and Doug would be happy for me to say at least 6, additional national parks, which, if created, or rather, should I say, when created, will protect well over 10 million more acres of wild habitat. This work goes on. This work goes on and may even accelerate. And on some distant, distant morning, when 1,000-year-old Alerce trees stretch to the sky in Pumalin Park and giant anteaters and jaguars roam freely in Ibirá National Park, and grand herds of guanacos wander through the grasslands of the Chacabuco Valley in Patagonia National Park, Doug's brief moment on this once and future wild earth will be reflected in those habitats in those creatures, his vision embodied in their genetic lineage and their evolutionary potential. His work for beauty and for wildness. Our work, Chris's work, for beauty and for wildness will have no end. And continuing the theme of Doug as great teacher, I give you Quincy Tompkins Imhoff.
Thank you. We didn't grow up going to church on Sundays. And today, we're not in a sanctuary of ancient trees or in a magnificent architectural building, as might be more fitting of Doug. We are quite simply here together as people connected by loss, but much more importantly, united by shared experiences. For weeks, the title of my talk was The Teacher of Hard Lessons. I have lists of character-building experiences that my sister Summer and I braved, like the one Christmas when I was 5 and we got an exorbitant number of presents, bright and shiny toys, one after the other. And then Doug explained that we could each keep just one, and we would be delivering all the rest to an orphanage. Wow, that was a hard lesson. I realize, though, that I don't need to describe these hard lessons. You know them because they are your stories, too. Many that you learned from Doug as well. How to work hard, that no detail is small, think big, never let your imagination limit your potential. And don't be afraid to stand up for what is right. Because we didn't go to church, I sometimes felt that I may have been missing out on something, an ethical structure, a ritual that had meaning. Oddly enough, it took me many years to realize how spiritual our lives were. We literally had a spree. An esprit de corps, or a spirit of the people, and many of you are those people. We worked together, we played together, we married each other, we had families. You could raise your hands if you're in that category. Lots of people. We were baptized on esprit river trips, and we made missions to far-off countries. We shared a language and a style that quickly spread around the world. We were a tribe that rallied around very dynamic leaders, Doug and Susie. We acted like people with a doctrine. And then the mission shifted for Doug, and new frontiers were explored as he transitioned from entrepreneur to deep ecologist. Many of his disciples followed him south to learn new lessons and spread the gospel of conservation. Together, he and Chris forged new alliances and converted many to an awareness that gave wild nature and beauty the highest rights. There were miracles along the way and plenty of hard times that challenged our faith. Temples were built from the Los Angeles store, flagship store, to the stone masonry of the Patagonia Park Visitor Center. There were countless acts of God, from the fire that destroyed the Esprit headquarters, to floods, earthquakes, and volcanoes that covered the parks in ash. It could definitely rain 40 days and 40 nights in Renue. It was not uncommon to hear revelations about the end of the world. Doug was a visionary. Somehow he could imagine outcomes without getting stuck on the practicalities. Commit and then figure it out. We've heard that a bunch today. For all the amazing achievements, the businesses, the mountains climbed, rivers paddled, the parks, the books, the buildings, the farms and the ranches, his determination combined with hundreds, if not thousands, of dedicated souls helped to make it all happen. Thank you for being on his team, whether you were building the brand or saving the world. Thank you, Jib and Weston and Lorenzo, for doing everything you could to save him on his last adventure. Thank you, Yvonne and Rick, for adventuring with him to the very end. Thank you to the amazing team that pulled today's tribute together with love and tireless dedication. Thank you to my husband, Dan, for helping me honor Doug in word and in song. God, Doug, was not a god. He was my dad. He pushed me just like he pushed you, to work harder, to take less, and to give more. He reminded us what our jobs were, and still are, that this is our home, and we need to take care of it. You may think of him when you see a stray bit of trash in the landscape and not hesitate to pick it up, or when you need to force yourself to reach outside of your comfort zone, or maybe when you're driving 80 in a 20-mile-an-hour zone. I know I will think of him then. Generations to come will think of him when they venture south to the many landscapes he was inspired to save on a scale that is frankly biblical. They say that you don't regret what you do, but what you don't do. I do wish he'd been able to know his grandchildren better, and to know Summer and me as adults, involved in our communities, actively engaged in deeply meaningful causes. There were some things that weren't so easy for him, but his hard lessons shine through. May our ritual of gathering today to salute Doug and share our love for him give us all the strength to reach out and support each other in these and other worthy causes. My sweet grandmother, Doug's mother, will turn 100 in July. Her name is Faith, something that we all need. Doug has found his peace, and now it's up to us. Thank you.
We're extraordinarily fortunate to have one of this generation's most eloquent essayists and poets to close out the tribute to Doug. Some call him the poet laureate of deep ecology, which would explain Doug's deep admiration for Gary and his ethics. He's been a friend of Doug's ever since he walked into his North Beach shop back in the 60s. Please welcome Gary Snyder.
Remarkable day. And I've learned a lot today, hearing all of you, hearing so many of you talk about this, describe this, tell the stories about this absolutely remarkable human being. Doug Tompkins, that was with us for a while. One of the few people I think that I can think of that is really badder than I am. That's a lot. Of course, in a different style. But the very first meeting, hangout time, was in a bookstore in Berkeley. Maybe that wasn't the very first, but what we talked about was poetics. That's what he wanted to talk about. Doug never let up on anything, as far as I can see, in exploring, examining, questioning, and challenging what it might be that you could do with that. As several people have said already, behind that was his, I think, in a way, almost unique meaning for the word beauty, which could be the same word as wild. But then wild has to be understood, and I always try to make this point, not only as free and unbounded, but remarkably self-managing and extremely conservative. And all of these qualities were shared by Doug, too. So I'm finishing this long, wonderful event with a poem called For the Children, which was something that Doug himself liked for his own reasons many years ago. At one point, I spent time talking to Native American and Eskimo students in the little remote schools of Alaska, traveling by plane out to remote spots. And actually, we would talk about capitalism and poetry. What else do you talk about when you're someplace like that? It's For the Children is the name of it. And take children to mean the community of life on earth, I think is where that really points to. The rising hills, the slopes of statistics lie before us. The steep climb of everything going up, up as we all go down. In the next century, or the one beyond that, they say, are valleys, pastures. We can meet there in peace if we make it. To climb these coming crests, one word to you and your children, stay together. Learn the flowers. Go light. So I'll finish with a little commentary. We were talking about that poem in a high school out in the Aleutian chain. And the whole high school was about 13 people. And they all had Russian surnames. They were all part Russian Aleuts. And I said, well, what about that? What can you say about that last of instruction, stay together, learn the flowers, go light. And an Aleut lad said, stay together means you should know your family history, who your uncles and aunties, your grandparents were, what they did, where they're buried or where they will be buried. And then an Aleut girl said, learn the flowers mean you have to know where to put your crab traps and when to feed the foxes, because they were raising foxes at that time for the pelts. And then another Aleut girl said, go light. Ah, that must mean don't waste gas. Thank you very much.
Doug was a great Bob Dylan fan, and he could really torture you with Dylan. If that can be true. And yes, we're not in a church, but I think that Doug would approve of some country gospel music, and this is about as close to a country gospel song as Bob Dylan wrote. You will find the chorus at the bottom of your program. I have here Richard Heinberg on my left, who is going to play violin, and he worked with Doug on a couple of the last big book projects and was a close collaborator, activist collaborator with Doug. And my friends Lisa and Maria, who are going to help us take this song home. And I had this vision of filling this hall with the human voice, and so let's see what we can do. We'll sing chorus number one, and you guys can sing with us on chorus two and three in unison, I think. I shall be released.
Is a man who swears he's not to blame.